Welcome to Conversation with a Geographer. I'm Mike DeVivo, professor of geography at Grand Rapids Community College. And today, we're very fortunate to have Peter Hugill, professor emeritus at Texas A&M University, joining us. Peter, thank you so much for being with us today.
You're welcome.
As I normally start these interviews, I ask those geographers to reflect upon what inspired them to pursue geography. And you have a very unique career because you started in the UK, then went to Canada, then came to the US. And so I'll ask you to elaborate on some of those educational experiences as well. But first, what inspired you to consider geography?
I think it was, well, I had a great geography teacher in high school who was also a filmmaker and very much believed in field work. So we did a lot of field courses, a lot of field trips. He also made me take geology, which was great. So I had a good background in geology. But I think it was the fact that I understood that geography, as in the infamous words of Carl Sauer, should be learned through the soles of your boot. And that stuck with me. When I went to Canada to get a master's degree, I encountered Phil Wagner. He became my master's supervisor. Of course, he was a Berkeley PhD. Very much influenced me. He then persuaded me to look for my PhD at somewhere with strong Berkeley connections, and I ended up at Syracuse working for David Sofa. But my first attempt at a dissertation fell through, not because of anything Sofa did, but because I'd been stupid and not thought things through properly. And I'd become, you know, close to Don Meinig. And Don suggested that I go out and look at a village called Casanova, because, as he said, it's really interesting. And I went to Casanova and went, yeah, he's right. This is a really interesting place. And I need to figure out why it's an interesting place. And that resulted in my ending up writing what I always thought of as two dissertations, one of which was to David Sofa, which is very quantitative, and one of which was for Don Meinig, which was very historical.
So you did work with Sofa and Meinig, which is really a dream team of advisors in many ways.
It was also an 800-page dissertation.
Well, and how many books did you get out of that one?
But it got me going on. I've clearly, you know, sort of hung my hat on Berkeley. I was very much interested in the whole notion of diffusion and how ideas diffused, how technologies diffused. I always thought that the Berkeley School had only dealt with sort of pre-industrial sort of diffusion, you know, agricultural diffusion, all the sort of stuff that Carter did and obviously Sauer did, agricultural origins and dispersals. But Carter, who I was hired to replace here at Texas A&M, you know, did the same sort of stuff. And I wasn't interested in that. I was interested in the way industrial societies worked and high technology societies worked, and so what I always saw myself as trying to do was push that old Berkeley model into a modern sort of world, and Don Meinig was always very encouraging of that, even though that wasn't his area of particular expertise. He was always great about having me do that.
Well, it's interesting. Your work has been read by a number of historical geographers and historians and been much appreciated, and probably should be read by many more. I think your comments concerning the impact of the bicycle are very thought-provoking, especially with regard to we can say, women's empowerment in 20th century America, no?
Absolutely. And I have a really nice little article in Geographical Magazine on the bicycle. I actually got paid for that.
Getting paid is good.
It wasn't much. Bought me a couple of beers in London, but, you know.
But you've also looked at cultural landscapes from a different perspective, I think, and some of your work has seemingly dabbled in the way in which people of different ethnic groups, socioeconomic classes, exhibit certain behaviors on cultural landscapes.
I got influenced by Syracuse, who would have been on my committee had he stayed at Syracuse, he moved to San Francisco, a guy called Ellie Gerson, whose work I've long respected, but who never really published. He's always sort of been behind the scenes sort of guy. But he introduced me to basically Irving Goffman's work, The Presentation of Self in Everyday Life, Anselm Strauss's work, Mirrors and Masks. And he went to work, Ellie went to work in San Francisco Medical Center with Strauss. And I've maintained some contact with Ellie. But that produced the first major article that I published, which is the one in 1976 in the Annals of the Association of American Geographers. And I was looking at a landscape that I was familiar with growing up in South End, which was the landscape of the seafront. That put me into my dissertation work, which was to look at an elite landscape in upstate New York. That's published as Upstate Arcadia. That's my dissertation, basically. And I was interested in the way people had played with houses, and elites had encouraged particular sorts of behavior. I see exactly the same sort of thing here in Monte Vista. I'm living in a very significant historical neighborhood for San Antonio and for Texas, of course, with lots of very, very fine houses. We live in the very cheap end of the neighborhood in a house built in 1926 that's, you know, worth maybe $500,000-$600,000, and most of the houses immediately south of us are worth $4 to $5 million. And, you know, we have had people like Herb Kelleher, who lived in this neighborhood. He was the guy who founded Southwest Airlines, which we've all heard too much about in the last few days. but, you know, this is a really interesting neighborhood with a lot of very interesting people in it. And I think I see exactly the same sort of forces operating here. Elites need to, you know, persuade people that they are elite. That's Goffman, Presentation of Self in Everyday Life. And one of the ways they do so is by creating a certain sort of physical landscape that other people emulate. And that's what I saw in Casanova, and that's sure as heck what I see here.
Would you say that, with reference to some of your other work, this also relates to the diffusion of English landscapes to the U.S. in terms Very of the much. Development of a garden, which we call lawns for the most part?
Very much. Yeah, that's an article. That's one of my articles, you know, the English Landscape Tastes in America in Geographical Review. Yes, very much around here. We have a very good book on the history of Monte Vista written by an architectural historian at Trinity University, which is literally about four blocks from where I am. Very fine university. And it's just been republished. And I was trying to persuade Trinity Press to let me put a chapter in there on to sort of expand the book a little bit, because I want to talk about the Tudor revival houses in the neighborhood, which are, I think, very important, because they represent sort of this sort of English landscape taste in America coming in, particularly in the late 19th century, as Britain and America go through the rapprochement that will lead us into the sort of very long sustained special relationship, which, as a political geographer, I'm interested in.
It's interesting. You see that in some of the more upscale neighborhoods in Austin as well, the influence of some of those Tudor types of architecture, you know? It's captivating. Why is this type of architecture considered to be an indicator of affluence, I guess?
President Wilson, who is not one of my favorite presidents, by the way, because I thought idealism is not the best way to do things. But President Wilson, to encourage Englishness among immigrants, really wanted people to read English romantic novels, and pushed and pushed and pushed for that. And that created a whole sense of sort of involvement in the Tudor period. And I think you can in many ways trace this sort of the onset of Tudor revival housing to precisely that, to Wilson's push for immigrants to accept more Englishness.
Interesting. And as long as you mentioned Wilson, let's discuss for a moment the role of the U.S. and the U.K. in competing for a hegemony in the world stage, where Wilson was very important, as you discussed at the Versailles Peace Conference.
Yeah, the Transition in Power book, I fell into this book by accident in a way, because I found a set of comments by Wilson, that in the coming world, this is at Versailles, he says, in the coming world, there'll be three arenas of competition between us and the British. One will be in telecommunications, international communications, he says. One will be in international transportation, and one will be in petroleum. And boy, that's a hook for a book. You know, those are three obvious areas to focus on. I spent a lot of time in London at the National Archives, basically doing the petroleum stuff. Because the fight in the Middle East between Britain and America over control of the Middle East was incredibly interesting. The international communications thing I'd already done, of course, because I'd written the global communications book. I was able to expand on that a bit. And I paid attention to broadcasting, which I hadn't before, because I think wireless broadcasting in the 1920s and 30s was so critical. So I was able to do that. And then the international transportation, I sort of concentrated on two areas, shipping, of course, and then aviation, which I think was much more contested than a modern historian would pay attention to. But if you look at the late 1930s, it's pretty hard to separate Britain, Germany, and the United States in air transport. It's World War II that separates them thoroughly.
Indeed.
And pushing Britain down into very much second place.
Back to Wilson for a moment. The thought just occurred to me. I'm wondering if, with regard to these emphases that Wilson was concerned with regard to petroleum and communication and transportation, do you have any ideas to whether or not Isaiah Bowman might have influenced him in going in that direction? Or was that just completely Wilson?
I think it's completely Wilson. I think the international communication comes out of Admiral Ballard, who was chief of naval communications at the time. Naval communications are the critical area. If I can divert myself for a second, I got fascinated by the Marconi scandal of 1911 when I was working in the British Archives, because it involved most of the cabinet, including people like Churchill, David Lloyd George, you know, sort of, it was a total mess. There was a House Select Committee, there was a House of Lords Select Committee, and one of the things I was stunned by was that in the whole of the British National Archives, there's not a single mention of it. I mean, nothing in Premier's papers, nothing in Cabinet papers, and so I'm going, what the heck happened here? You know, this got hidden. It wasn't hidden from the popular press. It was well reported in the popular press. So I got interested in what might have happened. not at an academic level. I couldn't publish it because there was nothing academic about it at all. So I decided in retirement that I'd write a novel about it. So I'm sort of completing a geopolitical thriller, which is based on the Marconi scandal and what I think happened.
But excellent.
If you look at what, and so, you know, makes a long story short, by the end of the First World War, it's very, very easy to blame the Germans for the Marconi scandal, obviously, because they've lost the bloody war. The interesting thing is, what the Marconi scandal did was stop the British constructing a global network of wireless telecommunication systems, which the Navy desperately wanted. And at the end of World War I, there is in existence exactly that system built by the U.S. Navy.
Fascinating. Fascinating. That'll make a great novel.
I'm just sort of waiting.
No problem. Let's talk a bit about your relationship with Don Meinig.
Absolutely.
And you did you take courses with him?
I did. I took any course I could.
And would you care to comment on the manner in which he taught his classes and how that inspired students?
I was, funnily enough, he reminded me over and over again of my much-loved instructor in high school. He fervently believed in maps and maps on the chalkboard. He could make a map on a chalkboard just like that, as could my instructor in high school. And he made things come alive in that way. And that's something I massively respected about. I've never had that skill myself. I've never had that talent myself. And I've always sort of regretted that because I think that's one of the ways, you know, geography is a visual discipline. That's the importance of it. We teach people by showing them things in maps or in other visual ways. That's one of the reasons I was interested in film and actually did teach documentary film production for a while. I think if we don't see geography as a visual discipline, we miss it. We miss much of it. So I was lucky in that. When I was hired at A&M, Campbell Pennington asked me to teach the U.S. geography class, which I had obviously from Don Meinig, and I was basically, oh, fine. I'm only too happy to do that. I know this stuff well. But I think the other thing that that hit me about, you know, knowing Don well was, of course, Imperial Texas, which was one of the things that I consumed before I came to Texas. And have to this day, even today, I was talking to a member of our city council that said, well, if you want to understand Texas, you have to read Don Meinig's Imperial Texas. And he's looking at me. Well, come on, you know, you're a councilman in a major Texas city. How come? You need to know about Texas.
Well, I would agree. I would agree. I mean, Imperial Texas and Southwest, great, yeah. Great books for...
Both, everything Don wrote was marvelous, but I think I really do, even though, of course, America is such a masterwork, but I think Imperial Texas is a jewel.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's interesting, as an aside, but related, I was acquainted with... a faculty member at an institution in Pennsylvania who did his undergraduate degree at Syracuse. And he was captivated by Meinig. And he recalls some time, this must have been in the 60s, he recalls a time when all of the faculty were asked where they would enjoy or where they would find doing a sabbatical most rewarding. And apparently Meinig responded that he would find the Library of Congress most rewarding.
I can believe that. I've had an enduring love for archives.
Indeed.
And I have every single one of my books. It lives in an archive somewhere, as it were.
You know, there's something to going into a library and just smelling the old pages right off the shelves, just reaching out to you, wanting to tell their stories.
Exactly.
Okay.
I see the land, by the way, and on the other end of that, I said I very much thought geography was learned through the soles of one's boots. I think the landscape is a library. It's an art. It's telling you things as you walk through it. And I was walking through today with our councilman, because we're talking about some issues of traffic. So I chair the traffic safety committee for our historical association, and we've got some interesting traffic problems which we're trying to get fixed, and they're being very helpful about it. But we're walking through the neighborhood, and I'm talking about, and he's looking at me as if, my God, how the hell do you know all this stuff? And I'm talking about the houses and the house styles and, you know, the things that intrigue me about the sort of constructed landscape around us.
And you just say, hey, I'm a geographer. I carry the truth, you know?
I've been trained to read a landscape.
Absolutely, which is a beautiful thing. How geography and geographers, good geographers, can integrate all of these phenomena, engage in analysis, and make sense of the landscape.
It's about the published material that's out there. You try to put it all together to come up with a more complete picture of the world that we're living in and how we need to integrate into it and deal with it.
Indeed, and it can be an arduous task. It's very complex, but it's also very rewarding and very beneficial to society.
Yes, absolutely. And that's why we enjoy, I think many of us enjoy doing it because of that. So.
I guess so. So let's go back to Syracuse. So you finished your PhD at Syracuse. You taught at SUNY Cortland.
Yes.
And then you were asked to consider Texas A&M.
By Dom. I later found out that what had happened was George Carter had retired, and the department wanted to replace him at the associate professor level. And I was told later that they had interviewed six people, and either the people didn't, I'm told that in two cases, wives had said, you are not going to Texas A&M. Which at the time was perfectly understandable. It was a bit of a backwater.
It was known as Berkeley on the Brazos.
Well, that was their attempt, yes. When I talked to George Carter, and George Carter sort of, you know, patted me on the head, as it were, and said, well, you're one of the grandchildren, meaning one of Sauer's grandchildren, because I had both a master's and a PhD with strong Berkeley backgrounds. But I think it was Don who made me see that A&M was going to go places, and that I would be smart to take a job offer there. Like so many beginning PhDs, I went, well, it's a starter job. You know, I'll publish my way out of this place. You know, and, you know, it was good. I had a brand new child coming, and, you know, that's how we settled down at A&M. But I thought for the first few years, oh, well, you know, I'll move along, I'll move on. And every time I turned around, the department got better and the university got better. And there's a point where you go, well, this place keeps getting better. Why should I move to a better place? It's already better. My wife got a very good job here. She ended up as associate director of the Texas Extension Service. And so that helped a lot. We've had both our kids here. One of our daughters is in Austin, and the other daughter's living with us temporarily. She's a traveling nurse. So we've been sort of embedded in Texas, as it were.
And there you're not going to close the circle to go back to the UK then, I suppose.
No. No, I still have relatives in the UK and very good friends in the UK, and I still love the UK. I was born there after all. But you know, my home, I'm an American. I'm happy in America, and I've got a very lovely American wife who's from Virginia. Can't get much more American than Virginia.
Probably not.
Virginia Tech. She's old school Virginia Tech.
Well, and Virginia Tech and A&M both have the Corps of Cadets.
Oh, yeah. In fact, my wife is one of the very first women to graduate from Tech. I think her graduating class had 200 women in it.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's not many.
She's an alumni association there, so we do a lot of stuff with Tech.
Would you care to comment about your relationship with Campbell Pennington, who you served with at A&M?
Oh, Campbell was a trip. he was so old school. He used to spend every summer in Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, we even have. There were photographs in the department, which he finally removed, of him with mule trades. Going into the wilds of Mexico to do his field work. Campbell was hired. I don't know how many people know this story, but it has been written up and published in Southwestern Geographer, so I'm not telling tales out of school. Campbell was hired to fix the department. It was a mess.
Mm-hmm. And he had come from Southern Illinois, did he not?
Illinois, yeah. And before that, he'd been at Utah, I think. So that's where he got to know Don. But he was brought in at A&M to straighten the department out. I'm told he was given 2 years to straighten it out. And he basically said, I'm going to need more than that because I've got to make some hires. He hired Kenny White.
Mm-hmm.
Who was, I'm trying to remember who the PhD was out of Riverside, Berkeley-based PhD.
One of Ashman's students?
Yes. He hired Kenny to teach the physical geography classes, and Kenny was very, very good at that. I taught the graduate field class with Kenny for several years. He'd do all the physical stuff, I'd do all the cultural, historical stuff. And then the next year, he hired myself and Bob Bednarz to sort of get the human geography end back on track. Human geography for me, economic geography for Bob. Bob was one of Brian Berry's students from Chicago. So we were hired to sort of, you know, get the place back and running. And we did that well enough that the sort of death sentence was lifted. We didn't know the place was under death sentence when we were hired.
Mm-hmm.
We just thought, oh, it's a job and we'll go. Of course, Chicago had melted down. Well, I think Bob was teaching at Northwestern at the time, and you know, those universities were in a mess, so he was happy to get out of there. I was just happy to get a job with a baby on the way. But it was a good place to move, and Campbell really looked after his young faculty. You know, he gave us decent teaching loads. He gave us always a summer course, which was good to have for the extra income. He was very paternalistic, I think is the way I want to put it. But he did look after you. As long as you did what he expected you to do, you were pretty well looked after and pretty well treated. So I was happy to be there.
So he provided faculty with a high level of autonomy as long as they measured up to his expectations as departmental leader that was tasked with straightening the department at A&M out.
Yeah.
And he established a good foundation then.
Yeah, and you know, he had some other good people. Clarissa Kimber was very good. We're still friendly with Clarissa.
Indeed. Very good.
Joe Sonnenfeld, of course, died. George Carter, of course, George retired and died.
Mm-hmm.
We hired, I think Campbell was very insightful about who he needed to hire to get the department back on track. I know certainly with regard to Bob and I, we had to do a lot of undergraduate advising, which in retrospect I think was very good for us. because it made us learn a lot about degree programs and how mm-hmm. students could be helped through them. I advised most of the transfer students, which was pretty heavy duty stuff, and then had to graduate everybody. So, you know, it was, I learned, you know, to make sure everything was progressing smoothly. But I think those things are sometimes missed in modern departments because we take on professional advisors who and keep faculty away from jobs like that. And I'm not sure.
Agreed. I think it reduces the opportunities to develop that more personal relationship with students that enable us to really serve as solid advisors. And we can still do it. It's just slightly more precarious in larger departments.
Yeah, and we were not that large a department at the time. When I was hired, we were about eight faculty and maybe about 100 students total. Mm-hmm. What then happened was we our faculty governance was awful when I was hired. And in fact, in many ways, I think we were still under AAUP. I think the AAUP was upset with us. But we got a president in who finally approved the formation of a faculty senate. And that let the university really move into the modern era. The senate then put into place a core curriculum. And I was very early involved in the faculty senate. And Kenny White was too, Kenny, the guy, the physical geographer I mentioned. And we, between us, Kenny starting it off and me finishing it off, as it were, we got geography really wired into that core curriculum.
That's great.
Physical geography became part of the science curriculum. And human geography became part of cultural. Economic geography, of course, social science. So we hardwired the department in, and boy, did our enrollment explode.
Well, sometimes those are the ways we have to take a stand and expand our presence in institutions. Regardless, with just about a minute to go here, I'm going to ask you if you could reflect in your career and think of any words you can share with colleagues or faculty in geography or prospective students considering a career in geography. Do you have any words of advice?
I think what always has driven me, and we've talked about this quite a bit already, is trying to understand the world around me, both as a physical world that I live in and as the historical world that I have come from. And that's going into the archives, reading other people's work, but then also looking outside and seeing the physical constructs, the technologies we've created, the houses we live in, the way we interact with each other today. So it's part of this sort of complex world. It's utterly, completely fascinating. And if you aren't fascinated by it, don't be a geographer.
Absolutely. Peter, thank you so much for joining us today. This has been a great pleasure. And this concludes today's episode of Conversation with a Geographer. Thank you.